Well, we're glad you're here, and may the Lord bless you. And we're looking forward to a good hour together. And to you that's listening out in the radio listen audience, we most certainly appreciate you tuning in to the Northside Baptist Church Hour that's coming to you live right from the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church here in Athens, Georgia. Now, this is Preacher Edward speaking. We're hoping doing this hour we can be an inspiration to every one of you, and especially to our dear sick and shut-in ones that's disabled to be in God's house because of illness, because of their age, because of being handicapped. That's the real joy of being able to broadcast our morning worship service, and that we might be a blessing to those shut-ins.
If you have your Bibles today, I want you to turn to two places in the Word of God. Turn to the book of Acts chapter 9 and Philippians chapter 1. I'm speaking to you today on this subject, suffering. Just the one word, suffering. We have a lot of people that are suffering today and they can't understand why. And this message should help every suffering person that will be listening today. Now, this message and the singing will be on cassette tape. And this is tape number 133. Tape number 133 on the message, suffering. Now, you can write in and get these cassette tapes for a gift of $3 for each tape. And the money is used to help pay for radio time. And you write to me this coming week because it'll be a kind of a vacation week for a lot of people. People will be traveling hither and thither. Many times they're so busy they forget the broadcast and forget it's a faith ministry. And I depend entirely upon the people that love God to maintain this program on the air. As the message goes into the homes of shut-ins and various people, you that make it possible are the ones that's doing this, of course. I do my little part in preaching and helping in this respect. And you that have paid the radio expense, make it possible to get the gospel out. We work together in getting out the gospel. And I believe with all my heart when we stand at the judgment seat of Christ that you'll be rewarded for your part in this whole mission work. This radio ministry is of the Lord. God put me on the radio almost 36 years ago. We'll be 36 years if I manage to get through August of this year, daily broadcasting the gospel message. And I appreciate the privilege. A lot of people in heaven today because of this broadcast. Young men are preaching the gospel because of it. Missionaries on the field because of it. A lot of people saved, living for God today because of this ministry. And so you make it possible, you that's worked with us in getting out the gospel. My mailing address is Virgil Edwards, P.O. Box 501, Athens, Georgia. 30603 is the zip code number. I trust you're finding your place, first of all, in Acts chapter 9, then Philippians chapter 1. I was reading in a magazine this past week about this dear old lady, awfully proud of the fact that she didn't feel that she looked her age. She's 81 years old. It was a real hot day, and she walked into her drugstore and made a statement pertaining to the heat. Of course, she said, 97 today. One of the clerks reached out and shook her hand and said, congratulations, lady. She went home, took a bed for a solid week. Now, in Acts chapter 9 and verses 15 and 16, I will read today, and then going to read from Philippians. I want you to turn there. I always like for you to follow me in the Bible. And Acts chapter 9, verses 15 and 16. And the Lord said unto him, go thy way, for he is a chosen vessel unto me, to bear my name before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. I will show him how great things he must suffer for my name's sake. Now in verse 16, the Bible said, there Jesus said he would show Paul what great things he must suffer for his name's sake. In Philippians chapter 1 and verse 29, Philippians chapter 1 and verse 29, for unto you is given in the behalf of Christ not only to believe on him, but also to suffer for his sake. Now, speaking to you today on the matter of suffering, I want you to follow me as I give you other verses that bring these messages, or this message rather. We are living in a world of suffering. Now, I want us to find out what it is and what it does for us as God's people when we suffer for the cause of Christ. There's a lot of suffering in the world today. A lot of people on this globe and multitudes are suffering in their bodies. As we grow older, sooner or later, some faculty, some part of our body is going to give way, and it's going to produce suffering in our bodies if we live long enough. Certain parts of our body will wear out. They have failed to function as they should, and it's going to cause us suffering, and we all are suffering people. And there's some of you right now that's listening to me, you're suffering in your body. You'll never get a day without suffering in your body, and maybe you can't understand why. You must remember there's a reason for all things, and especially to the people of God. And number one, I want us to notice that suffering sometimes keeps us from sinning. Now, that's not the case all the time, but sometimes. In 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 7 through 9, it says, "Unless I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelations, thou hast given me a thorn in the flesh, the messenger of Satan to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure. For this thing I besought the Lord thrice, they might depart from me. And he said unto me, My grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me." Now here we find a man, the Apostle Paul. And if you recall in my text, I read where God said, "I will show him what great things he must suffer for my name's sake." And here he is suffering tremendously. He's meeting with a lot of opposition. He's suffering in his body, and he prayed that God might remove that suffering, that God might remove the very thing that was causing him to suffer. And he kept praying, yes, God, three different times from the very depths of his heart and soul, that God would move that thing that was causing him to suffer. And then finally, God gave him an answer. Did God remove it? No. God says, "I'm not going to remove it, Paul, but I'll tell you what I will do. I will give you grace to endure it." Now, Paul was a man that was very easily become elated. He's very easily, a person very easily become filled with pride. And God knew that. And had Paul not had this problem, he would have been, of course, affected with pride in his life that would have damaged his ministry. And God knew that. Paul just couldn't take that pride because it did something to him. He was a Jew that was well learned, had a great background, and he knew that, of course, that God knew, but God was permitting this to keep Paul from sinning. Now, there's a lot of people today suffering in their bodies, and if they did not have that problem, they would go out and commit sins that they should not commit, and God knows that. And God is allowing them to continue suffering in their bodies, but God is giving them grace to endure it, and that's part of their lot, and they might as well go ahead and accept it, because were it not for that suffering or that handicap, then they'd go out and do things they should not do and dishonor God and sin in doing so. So God said, "I'm going to keep you down. I'm going to keep you humble. I'm going to let you suffer. Because if you were strong, well, and healthy, then you would sin against me." That's exactly what God did for the Apostle Paul. Number two, suffering makes us confess our sins. There's a lot of people that confess their sins because of suffering that would not confess their sins were they not suffering. The psalmist said in Psalms chapter 32, verses 4 and 5, "For day and night thy hand was heavy upon me. My moisture is turned into the drought of summer. I acknowledge my sin unto thee, and mine iniquity have I not hid. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord, and thou forgavest the iniquity of my sin." So here we find, because of suffering, David was suffering tremendously in his body, And he knew he was suffering because of sin. David had a disease in his body on one occasion that many Bible preachers and teachers believe it was a venereal disease because of sin. And he prayed about it, that God would help him and God would forgive him and straighten him out. And that God did. And his suffering in his body made him confess his sins to God. David said, all night long my sore run in the night. And he cried to God because of this sore in his body, this illness. And he prayed that God would forgive him and help him and deliver him from this affliction in his body. And that God did. And suffering made him confess that sin to God and get forgiveness. We find in the book of Luke chapter 15, a certain young man thought he knew better than his parents. Thought, well, I'll just run away from home. I don't like the way things are going in my house anyway. They're a little too tight on me. They don't give me the privileges I'd like to have. And I'm going to leave home. His daddy didn't tell him he couldn't go. His daddy didn't beg him to stay at home. His daddy just let him alone. Probably his dad said to him, now listen, son, if you abide under my roof, you'll have to abide by my rules here. If you eat at my table, sleep on my bed, live under the shelter of my home, you'll have to abide by the rules of this home. Now, son, that's the fact. I want you to know that. It's up to you. Well, the young man decided that he didn't want to do that, and so he said, I want what I'm supposed to inherit. And the dad said, all right, if you want your inheritance now, I'll give it to you. And he gave him his inheritance. And the young man left home and got into serious trouble. Spent all of his money. He was hungry, barefooted, ragged, had no friends, no money. And he had to go out and eat the food that the hogs ate for a living. And he began to suffer. And as he suffered, he began to confess his sins. He says, I'm going to confess to my father when I get back. I sinned against heaven and in his sight. I'm not worthy to be called his son. And he was suffering, and he began to confess his sins. Now, there's a lot of saved people today. They never would have confessed their sins to God had they not become sick or had problems in their bodies or in their families. And there they began to confess their sins to God. They wouldn't have done that had that illness not come their way. And that illness brought about a confession of sin. I may be speaking to someone right now. You're suffering in your body, and you know that you're sinning against God, and God may just let you go right on and suffer until you come to the place where you're willing to confess your sins to God. You know what the sin is. Now, don't misunderstand me. I'm not saying all suffering is because of sin in a person's life. I'm not saying that, but some of it is. Now, I may be speaking to someone today. You're suffering in your body. You won't confess that sin. You won't give up that bad habit. You won't quit smoking them cool, lucky chamomiles. You won't leave that alcohol off. You won't give up those things you're doing that's destroying your body, and you're suffering because of it, and God's just going to let you suffer. Whereas if you confess it and get rid of it, then God might deliver you from that suffering. A lot of people are suffering today because of a certain kind of sin in their life that they're not willing to give up. Suffering makes us confess our sins as a general rule. Number three, suffering is a mark of sonship. Now, according to this Bible, every child of God sooner or later will probably do some suffering as a son. Now, the Bible tells us that in Ephesians chapter 2 and verse 19. Now, therefore, you are no more strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and of the household of God. So the Bible tells us now when we get saved, we're not a stranger nor a foreigner, but we belong to the household of God. You as a Christian belong to a family, and that family is God's family. You're God's daughter. You're God's son. And you may have to do some suffering as you sojourn as a child of God. In Hebrews chapter 12, verses 5 and 6, the Bible said, and you have forgotten the exhortation which speaketh unto you as unto children. My son, despise not thou the chastening of the Lord, nor faint when thou art rebuked of him. For whom the Lord loveth, he chasteneth and scourges every son whom he receiveth. Now, what is God saying there? God is saying, I'm child training you. I'm giving you a whipping. I'm letting you suffer in your body because of your disobedience to me. You have sinned to me, and I'm going to whip you for it. And there may be someone today that because of your sinning against God, God has given you a good lashing. You're getting a good whipping. You're getting a good chastening from God because you sinned against the Lord. When I was a boy growing up, my dad oftentimes would tell me not to do things. And if I became disobedient, my dad would take off his belt and he would give me a whipping. He used the belt. My mother would get a little sprig off a peach tree and she'd switch me with that thing, but that didn't bother me too much. I didn't mind my mother whipping me. But when my dad got a hold of me, I did mind that because he'd use his belt. My dad wore suspenders and also a belt. I never could figure out why he wore both, but I found out he wore these suspenders to hold up his trousers. He wore his belt to hold us young'uns up. And he didn't mind holding us up occasionally. He wasn't unmerciful, but he was stern and firm. He loved his children. And that's the reason he whipped us. Sometimes when he'd lay the belt on me, he did it because he loved me. And I was so glad he didn't love me more than he did because that's about all I could stand at that time. But anyway, he didn't abuse us. He didn't bruise us up, beat us unmercifully. He just gave us a good old whipping. My granddaddy, he used a razor strap. In those days, they had no razor strap hanging there in the kitchen, and they'd go out and sharpen a straight razor before they shaved. And whenever his children did something they shouldn't do, he didn't take off his belt. He wore overalls, didn't have on a belt. But he had a razor strap. He used that razor strap for something besides sharpening his razor. He sharpened them boys up occasionally. And he didn't mind using the razor strap. Now, we're living in a day now when parents think they're not supposed to chasten their children, but you'll have to disagree with God on that. God said you're to chasten your child if that child is disobedient. Amen. And if you don't chasten your child, God said you don't love your child like you ought to. Now, I don't think you ought to beat them unmercifully. You shouldn't bruise them or beat them to the extent that you have to send them to the hospital or something like that. But God said give them a whipping. If they need it, give it to them. That's what God said. That's good for them, and God expects you to do that. And if you love them, you'll do it. Now, that's why God chastens us, his children. That's why there's some right now suffering in body. God is chastising you because of your sins. Now, all suffering is not because of chastisement, so you better understand my message and not misjudge me or try to say something I did not say. There's a lot of good old saints of God today that's suffering, that's living as holy and as pure as any individual could live, and yet they're suffering. And that's for a purpose. Number four, suffering purifies. In Job chapter 23 and verse 10, the Bible said, he knoweth the way that I take, and when he's tried me, I shall come forth as gold. Now, old Job need to be purified. You have to purify gold to make it pure, and it was purified. He was purified through his suffering. He said so. And I couldn't stand here this morning in the next hour and do justice to the suffering of Job. He suffered tremendously. But Job said, God was purifying me. And did you know through your suffering, God may be making out of you a greater Christian? Some of the greatest saints of God that's alive today were made that way through suffering. And God may be letting you suffer to make you a better Christian. He may be purifying you like he did Job. In 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 7, that the trial of your faith, being much more precious than of gold that perish, though it be tried with fire, might be found unto praise and honor and glory at the appearing of Jesus Christ. God may be purifying you to make you a better Christian, that you may receive a greater reward at the judgment seat of Christ. Some of the sweetest Christians I ever known are suffering Christians. I referred a moment ago to my uncle and aunt, Cleo and Nellie Carruthers. We visited their home this past week, and they were very sweet, humble couple. My, how he suffered in the past many years, and his good wife has stood by faithfully, but they're humble and as sweet as you find anywhere in the Lord. And they've suffered. He suffered tremendously. And a lot of times our suffering purifies us and makes us greater Christians to the glory of God. Then we come to thought number 5. Sometimes we are called to suffer. That may be part of your calling as a Christian, to suffer. Now you may say, preacher, what do you mean to tell me there's such thing as a call to suffer? That's exactly right. God may have called you to suffer a period of time. And 2 Peter chapter 2 and verse 21, for even hereunto were you called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that we should follow his steps. See, the Bible said sometimes we are called to suffer. Our Lord suffered, and we are to follow his steps. We find a young boy in the Old Testament at the age of 17, was sold out into Egyptian bondage by his brethren. He spent years in jail down there with his feet in the stock, and those chains around his legs hurt his legs. He was an innocent boy. He loved the Lord, but he was called to suffer. God had a reason for him suffering there in that jail. He hadn't done anything wrong. And so he suffered there in that prison for a number of years, and God was getting him ready to be prime minister in the land of Egypt. And many times your suffering is going to make you better fitted to do what God Almighty wants you to do. A lot of heady, haughty, high-minded Christians today would never be worth a dime had they not suffered in their bodies. They'd be so arrogant and so filled with pride and so stubborn until God could hardly use them. And God allows them to suffer and bring them down and humbles them through suffering that you might make out of them a better Christian or get them ready for a job in the future. Joseph was such. We find that Job likewise was called to suffer. Job was a godly man. He loved the Lord. He may have had a little pride in his life, but he loved God and very much concerned about the spiritual welfare of his family. And God called him to suffer. The devil put up an argument against God and said, now if you'll do this to Job, or allow me to do thus and thus to Job, he'll backslide and he'll curse you to your face. And God said, we'll just call him to suffer and see what he'll do. And Job had a call extended to him, and that call was a call of suffering. For 7 days he suffered so until his friends came and just sat there and looked at him, didn't speak to him for a week. He was in such agony. And then they started finding fault with him. His wife turned against him, lost everything he had. God said, Job, I'm going to extend to you a unique calling. I'm going to call you to suffer. And God called him to suffer, but in the end, he was purified, came out as pure as gold, became a giant for God. God gave him more in the end than he had in the beginning. And he lost 10 children, but in the end, he had 10 precious children, 3 of the most beautiful girls in the land, 7 beautiful, fine, handsome boys. And he lived to be an old age and saw his grandchildren. And when he died, his children carried his body to the grave and thanked God for Dad. All of this was brought about through suffering. God called Job to suffer. And if your call is a call of suffering, just be obedient to God. God has a purpose for it. The Apostle Paul, likewise, he spent months and years in jail without a cause, in a dirty, stinking dungeon. He spent time there suffering in jail. And in the meantime, he became a greater apostle and wrote much of the New Testament epistles. God called Paul to suffer. God said, I'll show him what great things he must suffer for my name's sake. Then we move on to thought number 6, and that is suffering produces fruit. A lot of us wouldn't bring forth any fruit unto God were it not for some suffering in our lives. Now the early saints of God suffered, some put to death, some beaten. And when they were whipped by the leaders and Pharisees and Herodians and whatnot, they went out praising God and rejoicing that they were counted worthy to suffer for the cause of God. And that produced more fruit. When they whipped them for telling somebody about Jesus, they took the whipping and went out and told that many more about Jesus. And so it produces fruit in our lives many times. There are people today, because of their suffering, they have been greatly used of God. Whereas had they not suffered, that never amounted to anything for the Lord. And if God has called you to produce fruit through suffering, then don't argue with God about that. God knows what he's doing. You take that little oyster down in the sea, there in the muck and the mire under the water. A little grain, a foreign element, lodged there in his little body. And because of that, it produced a beautiful pearl. And eventually that pearl probably ended up in the beads of a queen, on the crown of a king. But that little suffering oyster down there, through its suffering and suffering and suffering, produced that beautiful pearl. And through your suffering, many times you produce something for God. There's a man by the name of H.J. Spadford. Spadford wrote the words to the song, "It Is Well With My Soul." Don't you love that beautiful song? "It Is Well With My Soul." Spadford lost all he had during the Great Chicago Fire. And then he sent his family ahead of him to go to Europe. He was planning to go to Europe. And he sent his family ahead. He was to follow 2 weeks later. The ship sank and his four children were drowned. Mrs. Spadford, who was rescued, sent him a cable with these words, "Saved alone." That meant she was the only one out of the family that was saved. Shortly before he had lost his family, he lost everything he owned in Chicago. Of that great tragedy and personal suffering came the words that have comforted millions and millions, the words of the song, "It is well with my soul." Through suffering, that man wrote that song. And what a blessing it's been. There's an old mother hen one time out in the far west when prairie fire swept over the field there. The old mother hen called the babies underneath her wings. And as some men walked across to see the damage of the fire, they thought it was an old bunch of broom sage and they kicked it over. Underneath mother hen ran some little baby chicks. She had suffered that fire, that smoke, and that flame to save her babies. She gave her life for them. And then we come to thought number 7. Their self-inflicted suffering is useless. The heathen today, they cut their bodies. They put rings in their nose and ears, and they torment their body, run through fire. And they're in their paganistic and heathenistic worship. They damage their bodies, inflict suffering, but that's worth nothing. God never called anyone for self-infliction in order to suffer for him. That's not to be. God didn't tell you to inflict your body in the matter of suffering in that respect. And so self-inflicted suffering is useless. And then number 8, suffering will someday be over. I'm glad about that, aren't you? Suffering will someday be over. In Romans chapter 8 and verse 18, "For I reckon that the suffering of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed unto us." And so one of these days when you get your new body, all your suffering will be over. In 1 Peter chapter 1 and verse 25, it tells the word of the Lord shall continue forever. In Psalms chapter 72 and verse 17, "The name of the Lord shall endure forever." In Psalms 104 and verse 31, it says, "The glory of the Lord shall endure forever." So we know the word of the Lord, the name of the Lord, the glory of God shall endure forever and forever. But we do know then that suffering will eventually be over for the people of God. If you're suffering today, ask God to give you grace and give you strength, because one of these days your suffering will be over and you'll get a brand new body like unto the Lord's, never to suffer anymore. Amen. According to history, many years ago, Queen Victoria and Prince Albert were married. This is one couple that loved each other. Usually the kings and the queens and the prince and princes, they're put together in marriage when they don't even love each other. But on this particular case, Queen Victoria and Prince Albert loved one another dearly yonder in England. One day, Prince Albert died. Queen Victoria was very, very grieved. She grieved for hours about her lost husband. She loved him. Grieved for days, grieved for weeks. Then one day she said, "I want to take a ride. I want to go over into Wales. And there they placed her in a carriage with her bodyguards and so forth and the horsemen. And they went over to Wales. They'd been notified in Wales that Queen Victoria would soon be coming through the little village. And all the people decorated their homes. And then they came out on the street and to wave at her as she went by. There's the Lord Mayor sat beside the Queen on the way down the street there in Wales. They were going along, the people waving. But they came to a little home where there's no one in front of that home waving. The home wasn't even decorated. And the Lord Mayor said to Queen Victoria, said, Queen, I must apologize, said, the reason that home there has no one out waving as you go by, and the reason that home is not decorated for your trip through Wales, that dear wife just recently lost her husband, and she's very much grieved. And that's why she's not out waving, why her house is not decorated. She's so grieved over her husband. Queen Victoria said, stop this carriage. And they stopped the carriage. She said, I'll be back shortly. She walked up to this door of this little humble home, and she knocked on the door, and she went in. She stayed a while. Then she came out. She got in the carriage without saying a word, and the Lord Mayor started the horses, and down the street they went. When Queen Victoria left to go back to her castle, to her home, the Lord Mayor took off to this woman's house. He was going to rebuke her for not decorating, for not being out there waving for the Queen as she went by. He goes to the door and he bangs on the door. A little humble voice on the inside said, come in. And he walked in. He said, I want to know why you didn't come out and wave at the Queen and why you didn't decorate your house. But most of all, I want to know, what did that Queen say to you? The humble woman said, she sat down beside me and she put arms around me and she told me she too had lost her husband and she was very much grieved and she could understand why my home wasn't decorated and why I was not waving, and said, we sat there and we wept together, and she hugged me and kissed me and then she left. Beloved, that's what Jesus did for us on Calvary. He suffered, he bled, he died, he paid the sin debt. We might not go yonder in hell and suffer forever. And if you don't know him today, you ought to turn to God, repent and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. Let us all stand to our feet. Our Father, I pray today in Jesus' name that you'll take this message and use it. No doubt there's people suffering today and they can't understand why. May this message help them, our Father. May this message cause them to ask for more grace, that they might endure it. If there's unsaved people in this church or out in the radio listening audience, speak to their hearts. We know there must be many unsaved out there. I pray for all the suffering saints of God, wherever they may be, whether in this building or in the radio listening audience, in Christ's name, amen. While John plays a couple of stanzas, if you're in this building and you need something, like you need to get saved, you need to come back to God, or you want to join this church, or for any reason, any problem, anything that might be bothering you, that you could come down here and let me help you, I'd be glad to do so. I have given you the message that God gave me to give you. God knew who would be here. God knew who would be out in the radio listening audience to get the message. I've done my part. I've tried to be faithful in doing what God wanted me to do. Now, are you willing to do what God wants you to do? We'll wait just a moment. How about it? God is speaking. Obey the Lord.